Good morning, everyone. I'd like to thank the organization for inviting me, and Alexander in particular for organizing the conference. Well, today I talk about functions in Lua. It's a little something I've been thinking about, the importance of how functions contribute to Lua. Most of the time when people learn Lua, when people talk about Lua, always tables is kind of the special stuff about Lua. And I'd like to discuss today how functions are important, how they play a very kind of a deep role into the design of the language. So first, we would like to discuss what function mean. I mean, there is a lot of different words that people use to describe what actually doesn't have a real proper name. People sometimes talk about anonymous functions, function values, or first-class functions, closures, lambdas. Each one actually means something a little different. They do not, and none of them means exactly what most people want to talk when they talk about that kind of function. So what we are talking about, the first important property we want from functions in good languages nowadays is that they are first-class values. What does that mean, that functions are first-class values? First, it means that functions are values, so we can assign them to variables, we can pass them as parameters to other functions, we can return from functions from other functions. Is it working? The sound? Yeah. And of course, we can also store functions in data structures in general, just like any other values. Of course, when we can pass functions as arguments and we can return functions, we have what's called higher order functions, which exactly are the functions that receive other functions or return functions, that it functions that somehow manipulate functions. And something that it's not, some people think it's obvious, but it's not, is that we can call those functions anywhere in a program. I mean, as long as you have the value in your hand, you can call it no matter what happened before, no matter what, where the program is. If you have the value of a function, you can call it. This is what we call first-class values. The second important property we want is that functions can be nested. That means that we can define functions inside other functions. So for instance, here I have a function foo, and inside that function, I define another function p. And of course, this is recursive. So inside p, I can define another function, et cetera, how many levels I want. The third important property is that the language allows you to write what it's called anonymous functions, which, as the name says, is functions that don't have a name. And synthetically, that means that we can write a function as an expression into your language. For instance, here is an example. I have inside the parentheses, what is in red is an anonymous function. I just write the function where I need it. I don't need to pre-declare the function somewhere else, give it a name when, for instance, I want to pass it as a parameter to some other function or whatever. I need to create a function. I just write it exactly where I want that function. And finally, what it's really very important too is that when I write a function inside another function, we have what it's called lexical scoping, which means that the function can access the variables of the enclosing functions where it lives. This is the classical example. I have a function makeCounter, which has a parameter n. Inside that, I declare an anonymous function, and that function can access that outer variable and can not only read it, but can write to it and can change its value, etc. And here is a typical use. I make a counter, and then I can use that counter, and the function somehow keeps that n alive. And what is very important, as is presented in this example, is that a function can escape from this enclosure. That is, this function here, it is returned from that one, so it escapes. So when I call this function, this external one, it doesn't long exist. It disappeared, but the variable, this n, still exists, is kept, because this inner function uses that. So this is a little tricky sometimes to implement that in an efficient way. We will discuss the implementation in the end of the talk. But this is a very important property, as we will see later, why we need that. And as I said, people that know functional languages or that learn this stuff in some decent languages or more modern languages tend to think of all that as a unified thing, but actually they are very different concepts, and along the time we had different languages with very different properties. So here are a few examples. For instance, C has actually, when you use pointers to functions in C, is exactly the same as first class values. We can pass functions as parameters, we can return functions, we can call them whenever you have the pointer to a function, you can call it. So actually in C we do have first class values, we can store those pointers anywhere, but we do not have nesting, and then we do not have anonymous functions, and of course we do not have lexical scoping. In Lisp, the original Lisp has functions as first class values. It did have anonymous functions, but it didn't have lexical scoping. It has what it's called dynamic scoping. That actually was a bug, but became a feature. And then the scheme corrected that. Lisp now it has both. It has both lexical scoping and dynamic scoping. But the original implementation, because of a bug, didn't have lexical scoping. Pascal, the original language, Pascal, it does have nested functions. You can declare functions inside other functions. They do have lexical scoping. A function inside another one can use the variables from outside it. But functions are not first-class values. The only thing you can do with a function is to pass it as parameters to other functions or to call them from where they are visible. You cannot store them in variables, and in particular, they cannot escape. Exactly, they cannot live outside the function where they are declared. You cannot return a function, for instance. And Python 2 and Java, now Java 8, even have anonymous functions, but they still do not have lexical scoping for variables. You cannot change an external variable. You can only access the external variable. Python 3 corrected that. Java still has this limitation. And for instance, in Ruby and Smalltalk, we have a thing that is called a block, that is a kind of function value that you can pass as parameter, but it's not first class. There are some rules when you can call it. For instance, you cannot store that in a variable and call it later. So these are examples of why those concepts are somewhat independent. And none of them, this is the most strange thing, none of those names that I presented, anonymous functions, lambdas, or first class values, actually mean what we want to mean. We should say, I think the correct would be to say something like first class functions with lexical scoping, which is a horrible name for something, but that's what we have to say to be correct. So now I'd like to discuss how Lua uses functions, and exactly not only uses functions, but how Lua uses those specific properties of functions to achieve its goals. And before that, I'd like to discuss what are the goals we are talking about. So I'd like to discuss here some of the most important goals in Lua, and in particular, simplicity and scripting are the most important, I mean, the ones that functions contribute most to achieve in the language. So first, portability is a very, very important goal of Lua. That when we talk about portability in Lua, it's a different concept of portability from most other languages. First, because it really runs almost anywhere that has a CPU. And second, because it's really easy to port. I mean, portability is not only that Lua runs, but it's easy to run. If you get a new hardware, you just put Lua there. Some people, I have several stories about, oh, okay, I had to spend like half an hour to put Lua to run in a completely different hardware. So that's all it takes to put Lua in any kind of CPU. And as an example of real portability, that Lua even runs inside the kernel of operating systems. That, of course, then it's a very difficult code to run. You don't have an operating system behind you. You have to do everything from primitives. And actually, the FreeBSD distribution now comes standard with Lua included in its kernel. And Linux doesn't come, but there is an implementation of Lua, a module of Lua that you can put inside the kernel of Linux to automate several different tasks there. Well, simplicity, it's something that is more difficult to measure, but a kind of proxy for simplicity of the language is the size of the reference manual. Unlike most languages that you have like Bibles to read about the language, the whole language, the API with C, the language itself, the libraries, are described in the manual. That this is the spine of the manual. This is the in proportion to the book. It's like 100 pages. That's all you. Actually, everything is there or should be there. And a lot of people actually do learn Lua from the manual. Of course, it's not easy, but it's possible. It's not a didactic material, but it's kind of the main documentation. And that's a kind of proxy for the complexity of the language. Size also is very important. Lua is a very small language. This is how the size of the whole implementation evolved with time. Here we have lines of code. So it's today still less than 25,000 lines of code. There are logical lines of code. Actually, it's a count of the number of semicolons in the code. It's a proxy for that. So we see that we are getting a little more documentation. We have a time here that was a little less documented. Now it's a little more comments. But still, it's a very, very small implementation. This is, as I said, it's the whole the precompiler, the runtime, the libraries, etc. And of course, the most important point of Lua is its ability of scripting. And here it's important to emphasize that now a lot of people are using scripting language as a kind of synonymous to dynamic languages, but they are quite different concepts. And scripting language has a very long tradition of being different from usually scripting language is a dynamic language, but not all dynamic languages are scripting languages. The main point of a scripting language is this emphasis on interlanguage communication. One of the first scripting languages were the shell languages in Unix systems that you use to control other programs. So the idea of scripting is that idea of some language to control other parts of your program that usually are written in a different language. And the general idea is that this what it's called the system language, that name came from TCL. The TCL guy was one of the first to kind of to formalize this idea, the Osterholt. And so this is, we call it the system language, typically C or C++. You write the hard parts of of an application, like a game engine, for instance, that has all the graphics, all the physics, all the real complex algorithms, and but are parts that change little in a program, and you use scripting to glue together those parts, for instance, in a game to create the exactly scripting. It's a very good name here that actually almost has the script of a movie. It's a what are the characters, what they talk, how they react to events, what are the scenes that your game have, the levels, etc. So everything is written in the script as part of the script. And usually the programmers that write scripts are not professional programmers, but are people more like end-user programmers or people that are trained in what they have to do and not in program. So usually, of course, they are programmers. If they are programming, they must be programmers, but they are not professional programmers. They have other more important interests in their lives. So what Lua has for scripting? The first Lua is implemented as a library. This is a very important point of the design. The standalone application is just a client of this library, and it uses the official API just like anybody else. Since the beginning, Lua has been designed for scripting. We will discuss that when we see how functions are important in the language. We'll see how functions contribute for this. A lot of people think that scripting, you can just get a language and put the API and then you're done. It's true, but it's half the truth. I mean, to get a good scripting language, the design of the language has to think about how the language is going to communicate with other languages. In particular, the design of Lua makes it very good both for what's called extending and for embedding. Extending is typically you get a Lua program and then you put extra functions written in C, C++. And embedding is the reverse. You have a C, C++ program and you add small hooks or any way to configure or to change small parts of the program using Lua. So the main loop is in C and it's calling Lua and a lot of languages that call themselves scripting languages are really bad for that kind of design. And in particular, we do have real uses of Lua embedded not only in C++, but in a lot of different languages, including several real uses like embedded in Ruby and in Python, etc. Exactly because of these scripting features of Lua. And so back again to see how Lua uses functions to achieve those goals, mainly simplicity and scripting. I mean, this a good API with C, with other languages. Well, first example. Is modules in Lua. We always talk about, oh, modules are just tables. Actually, modules need tables and first-class functions to be able to, for us to be able to implement. Here is a typical example. We use a module most like any other language, but actually what is going on here is that we are just calling a first-class function that is the value that we stored in a table. We have several facilities for free because they are everything is our first class, so we can give different names for the modules, we can give different name for the functions. We don't need any extra syntax or any extra anything in the language to have that. The only thing we need is a function required that again is a completely regular function that returns a table full of functions inside it. What we need from functions for that, first of course we need first class values. Also it's very useful lexical scoping, because then this is a very common practice. When you write a module, you can have local definitions inside the module, and all functions inside the module can see those local definitions because of lexical scoping, but nobody else can see those local definitions. So you have kind of private functions inside the module. What are good about that? As I said, we don't need new features in the language. As I said, this is very convenient to interface with other languages. For instance, in the API, we also don't need anything at all in the API with C. For instance, if C wants to call a function in a library, it just gets the table with just a standard operation for tables, get the field in the table, and then it has a function and it calls that function just like it calls any other function. In the same way that C can define functions for Lua, it's very easy for C to put those functions inside a table and return the table. So it's very easy both for C to call functions inside libraries and for C to create libraries, and we don't need anything extra in the API between Lua and C. All that come from free because of this design using functions as a basic ingredient for. And the cons, what it's bad in this design, that of course sometimes it's nicer to have good syntax to rename some stuff. Some people complain that you have to repeat the name of the module. For instance, when you write here, you have to write math twice, that it's very bad. And I don't care, but a lot of people do. So it's nicer if you do have, you have that specific. But everything that you put in the language, then you have to replicate in the API, or you have this problem that you can do in the language, but you cannot do in C, and there is this all that kind of problems. And another bad point about that is because everything is first class, this design is too dynamic sometimes. For instance, there is no secure way to know all the modules that some piece of code use. If you program with a discipline, it's very easy to see require the string here, but because this is a regular function, here can be an expression, you can compute in runtime what is the name of the module you are requiring. You can have a require inside a if, and then it's a conditional require. So there is no secure way to ensure that if you have that piece of code, that are the modules that this code use. So this is, it's nothing really bad. In C we have the same problem, that people grew up using .h files, etc., and then it's a discipline that is kind of part of the people even think it is part of C, that all those stuffs about includes and header files, that's completely out of the language. It's just a culture that grew with the language, and once you use that way, everything goes fine. So another interesting thing in Lua related to functions is the eval, or the lack of eval in Lua. Eval is a hallmark of dynamic language, the idea that you can run a piece of code dynamically. And that's very important, that a lot of people say, oh, of course, I can write an interpreter of any language in the language itself, so any language can have eval. For instance, I can write in C a function that gets a piece of C code and runs it. That's, of course, that it's possible. But the main difference between a real eval and a fake eval is that you run that piece of code in the same environment of the program that it's calling eval. That is something you cannot do in C, you cannot do in Haskell, you cannot do in static languages. In Java, you more or less can do if you load classes, that is kind of official part of the language, but you have to go a long way to do that, but it is possible. But in C, in standard C, there is no way to write a function like I equals y plus one, and it knows, oh, which is this I, where it, oh, this is a global variable, etc. Some systems you can try use like find symbol or those things, but this is completely out of the standard. But the interesting point about Lua is that Lua doesn't have an eval function, instead it has a compile function that is called load for historical reasons. And the idea is that load, instead of executing a piece of code, it returns a function that represents that piece of code. So eval and load are basically equivalent. I mean, here is, if I do have load, it's very easy to write eval. I just load the code and then calls the resulting function. If I have eval, it's not that easy, but it's possible to write load. You just put the code inside a function. You concatenate function, a header function, with your code and end in the end. And you evaluate that, the result would be a function that represents that code. So eval and load are more or less equivalent in the sense that you can do one with the other. But why we prefer load, what is good about load? First, it clearly separates compilation from execution. In particular, load is a pure function. Load doesn't have any side effects. Load is a safe function. You can call load. Load is not going to destroy anything. It's not going to do anything except consume a little memory. And even memory is limited by the size of the chunk you are compiling. It's easier, as we said, as we saw in the last slide, it's easier to do eval from load than the reverse. So load, again, in that sense, is a kind of more primitive. And also it's nice because any code in Lua always runs inside some function. So we do not have this idea of you have global code and function code that is the body of a function. All code runs like if it was here, so all code always runs inside some other function, which means that we are using nested functions in Lua all the time, even without thinking about that. So again, this is very important, this idea of functions being first-class values with nesting and with lexical scoping. In particular, chunks can return values because they are functions. I can just put a return in the middle of a script, and it does what you would expect, is just stop the execution of the script because that function returns. You can have local variables in a script, and it looks like this local variable is in the open, but it is inside a function. And lexical scoping allows you to use that local variable in all functions inside the file, as it was like a more or less like a static variable in C. It's quite the same as a static variable. It keeps its values between different calls to the functions in that file. So another interesting thing we use functions in Lua is for exception handling. This is in red, this is not Lua, this is important, this is how most languages do exception handling. You have a try, and you have a catch, you have a special syntax and a special semantics, and some languages have the catch and then has a finally, and has a lot of different rules to describe what happens if there is an exception inside the catch, or if there is an exception inside the finally, or if there is a return inside the finally, and then when you are executing the value to be returned, it throws an exception, etc., etc. It's quite complicated, but it's very nice. It's a very good structure. In Lua, we don't have anything like that. We just have one kind of magical function called pcall from protected call, that it is a higher order function. It gets a function as an argument, and what it does is that it just calls that function, but in a way that if there is any kind of error in the execution of that function, pcall kind of captures the error and returns politely to you a result. So typically we use pcall with an anonymous function here to replicate that, but of course I can put any function as a parameter to pcall, and pcall will return a code, a true or false, depending whether there was errors or not. And if there was an error, it returns here a kind of error object. It's the same thing that in here, that you throw an exception, you get here the exception. Here we call error, is a function that kind of throw the exception, and you pass a parameter to error, and that parameter appears here, and then you can check if there is not okay, then you can have your exception code with error. It's a kind of very different design. Some people will say it's a kind of strange design. It has some good parts, some bad parts. Again, we have to see the goals of Lua to actually evaluate that. First, as I said, it's very important to have anonymous functions with lexical scoping in the language, so we are able to write code here as if not notice that here the code is inside a function, but if we have lexical scoping, that code can use the variables outside here exactly as the code here. So it's basically that's why also we use that kind of strange indentation that's typical in Lua. We just ignore that you are inside another function. You can pretend, except if you have a return here, everything else here works exactly if it was outside the function. And so what's good about this design? It is a very simple semantics. We don't have that complexity of what happens, etc. Everything is simpler. We don't need any extra syntax. Again, the languages just have two functions that although the implementation of the function is magic, the function behaves as a regular function. You call them just like regular functions, and they are first-class functions. They are just, you can pass them as parameters, etc. And the most important thing, it's very easy to interface with other languages. Exactly, we just have a pcall in the C API and an error in the C API. So it's very easy to throw an exception in C calling error and to capture the exception, to catch the exception in Lua. It's very easy to throw an exception in Lua calling error and to catch the exception in C, and all kinds of combinations are very easy. And what's the bad parts? It's a little verbose. As I said, the body cannot have a return or a break if the body is inside a while. And this is kind of old now, because try is not cost-free. This is an old idea of C++. For instance, in C++, there is this notion that try should have no cost at all. You don't pay any price to put some code inside try. You only pay the price if there is an exception. If you throw the exception, then can be very expensive. But try should have no cost. But this is an old idea of JavaScript, for instance, now. Last time I heard, V8 doesn't even try to optimize functions that have try inside them. So try, it's very expensive in some other languages. If you just put try, the whole this function is not supposed to be fast. I don't care about it. So, and in Lua it's the same. We pay a little price to create this function here and to do the call. It's not that very expensive, but of course there is some cost in doing that. I will skip iterators. There is not that interesting. Huh? Let's see iterators. No. Let's see objects. That. Well, this is a very compact explanation of objects in Lua. I assume most people here know about that. The main idea in Lua of objects are just tables with first-class functions inside them. And we have this synthetic sugar for methods. For instance, a colon foo means a dot foo, passing a as the first argument. So we have a kind of self or this parameter. And when we declare the function, it happens the same, so it's only synthetic sugar. Again, the main point here is that functions are just methods are just first class functions. And again, what is good about that? It's very flexible. It's very there is some discussion in the list now that you want to chain dots and columns, but the interesting part is that you already can do that with a little extra code. I mean, it's very easy to call super or to call, I want to call that method of that other object with whatever, or I mean, you can do whatever you want with that design. Again, the main part is the API. It's very easy to interface that. We don't need anything extra in the API. Again, it's very easy for C to call methods in Lua. They just call a function providing the this parameter explicitly. And the reverse, it's very easy to write methods in C. Again, they are just regular functions. So the API, again, it's very, very clean between Lua and C or any other language, because the API has no notion at all about objects or classes, etc. The API works with tables and functions, and whatever is built on top of that, it's just go through the API without any limitations. The cons of a lot of people that work with Lua have this experience. You need some work to get started. It's a kind of do-it-yourself object system. And there is no standard model for, so different people sometimes have different object models and sometimes can be difficult to learn somebody else code because of that. 5 + 5 = 10. Okay. Well, the Lua C API a main point in the API is that functions are constructs that we found in just any other language. The notion of functions, of calling functions and returning from functions, is exactly the same in Lua, in C, or in Java, in JavaScript, etc. So it's very easy to translate that notion between languages. As I said, once you have a function in the API, you just call it in C. There is no thing about inheritance or about those concepts that are more difficult to translate. So as I said, a lot of features in Lua don't need anything extra in the API. And some features are actually the reverse. Both exception handling and load, they are actually, the primitives are in the API. They are functions in the API for Lua. And then we just get that function and export to Lua. So it's a kind of reverse, but again, it's very easy, this translation between the language and the scripting between the language and the other part. Have some time to talk a little about the implementation, how as I said, the most difficult part in the implementation of functions with those features is this idea of the variables, because usually we have this idea in imperative languages that variables, local variables, live in the stack, and when the function returns, the stack is popped and the variable disappears, and if a function inside that escapes and still wants to access that variable, the variable doesn't exist anymore, and so we need a way to solve that. One easy way to solve that is to put the variables outside the stack. This is what some Python does, for instance, but it's very expensive. To call functions become more expensive because you have to allocate space for those variables. Every function you call, you have to deallocate the variables when the function returns. So the idea is that we want an implementation that allows us to have the variables in the stack, at least when we are not using closures, and kind of to move them out of the stack when the stack is going to, when the variable would be going to disappear. So of course the idea is that we use closures. A lot of people use closure to talk about this whole idea of functions, but actually closure is a name related to one particular way to implement this feature. Functional languages like Haskell, for instance, don't use closures at all to implement what a lot of people call closures anyway. So the idea is that a closure represents, of course, the code of the function plus the environment where the function was defined. And the Lua uses a concept that we call up values to represent the environment. That is, a closure is the the code plus some special structure to represent each variable that the function needs to access outside from the outside. And the main idea, as I said, is that we want zero cost when we do not use closures. So we want to call functions to have the variables in the stack. So the basic data structure is, this is a closure. As I said, you have this is the code of the function. And for each variable, it has this special structure that is a value. And the main idea here is that, for instance, if you have here one function that uses y and x from the external environment, it refers here to a value that refers to the variable in the stack. So the function here can access the variable in the stack. That function here uses only x. And a very important thing, that's why we keep this list, is that it shares the same x of this function. We need why this share is in, we will see why this share is important in a moment. So we have this, the variables are alive in the stack. The function where the variables are defined just use the variables as any other variable. They are in the stack. They are, I mean, as I said, the original function has zero cost to access those variables. Only the closures, when used, that need this extra structure to access the variables. What happens when a function returns on, or when a variable goes out of scope, is that we have this idea. For instance, we have this scenario with x here, and then the top of the stack goes down, so we move to this point here, the variable goes out, so we move the value of the variable into the up value. Now the variable lives here. It doesn't need to live in the stack because exactly it went out of scope for the original function. And we correct this pointer so for the closure, it still accesses the variable in the same way it did before. Just go here, look for this pointer, and finds the variable here. And that is why it's very important to have only one up value for each variable, because if several functions were sharing an up value, once we move the value here, they continue to share this variable here. So for instance, if one function increments x, the other function will see x incremented. So this is a very important property. There are several details that I will not discuss, but the first thing is that it's possible to do that with a one-pass compiler. The compiler is very simple. It is what it's called a safer space. It means that we only keep the variables that we actually use. Some implementations keep the whole environment of the external function. And so, for instance, a function can have three variables. One, it uses a lot of space, but you are only using another variable, but you keep alive all of them because the implementation does not have granularity to distinguish that. Well, and some other details that are details. And so, final remarks. As I said in the beginning, Lua is not only about tables. And like tables, Lua itself uses functions for several important constructs in the language. I mean, the idea is that functions or closures or whatever name you want to give, it's not only something that Lua has to offer to programmers, but it's something that Lua uses to build several of other important constructs. And this idea of first-class functions greatly helps to make the C API simple and generic. That's what I had to say. Thank you very much.
So, questions? Guys, please wait for the mic to reach you. If the question is asked without the mic, Roberto, please repeat it for the camera.
if I understand.
What time did it take to come to the current state of functions in Lua? In the history.
Oh, that took a long time. Since the first version of Lua, this is interesting because exactly the history of Lua shows those different features of functions. Since the very first version of Lua, functions were first-class values, in the sense that we could pass them as parameters, could return them, but we didn't have nesting, we didn't have lexical scoping, was just the idea of. And then in version 3.1, we introduced the idea of anonymous functions, and then the declaration of function became syntax sugar for an assignment, as it is today. It's just a variables equals to an anonymous, so all functions became anonymous. But we didn't have lexical scoping. We only had lexical scoping for values. We could, like in Java today, a function could use the value of outside variables, but could not assign to those outside variables. And then in Lua 5.0, that was released in 2003, I think, we came with that implementation of up values, etc., that allowed us to have lexical scoping.
Okay, next question.
Is it possible to use protected call mechanism in the coroutine context?
To use what, sorry?
Protected call mechanism.
Oh, in
the
coroutines.
Coroutine context. Yes.
Yes. Yes. Mm. Now, yes. Mm.
Yes. Now, at version.
I don't remember.
5.1.
Don't remember 5.1. I think 5.1 already had that. 5.0 didn't have that. But I think 5.1, 5.2 and 0.3 for sure allows that.
Thanks.
Next question.
Maybe you ask about the structure for objects. We need in our product the know when object is the struct. And now we used CIP. Maybe in next version we have destructor for object.
Finally, for plain Lua objects.
Well, we do have, don't we? Finally, yeah. Or
I mean the finalizer, of course. GC.
GC, where we do have that.
GC only for user data, but
no,
plain
no,
object.
For tables.
Since what version?
5.2.
And oh. You probably use 5.1 with LuaJIT.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
That's a different language.
Okay.
Next question, please.
For what need it can be? It makes sense to embed Lua in some language like Python. In case of C, where we embed Lua in C, it's mm-hmm. rather obvious. And for what need it, it makes sense to embed Lua in Python, for example, mm. or Ruby?
Ask him. He embedded Lua in JavaScript. Python in particular, it's very interesting because I gave a talk in a long time ago, but to a PyConf in Brazil. I was invited for a talk about Lua in a Py conference, in a Python conference, and the slide didn't have Python at the time. And then one guy in the audience, he said, come on, you should put Python there. The main idea is exactly to have isolation. He has a huge Python program, for financial applications, and he wants the user to be able to write script, but he doesn't want the user to be able to change the whole program. And exactly in Python, you don't have this notion of different states, or like in Lua, or any kind of protection, real protection. So if you allows the guy to write any Python code, he can change the whole program, he can do whatever he wants in the program. So he allows him to write Lua, and so it has a very clear interface API between Lua and Python, and so it's very restricted what they can do in Lua. It's kind of a sandbox. That, and then when the guy said that, like three or four other guys, oh, I use for the same thing, etc.
For sure. Yeah. Thank you, Roberto. In 5 minutes, there's next talk. Thank you.